Okay, well, I'm Arlene McDonald, and I'm so pleased to be here interviewing Dr. Vivian Pinn. This interview is being conducted for the Renaissance Women in Medicine Oral History Project, which is sponsored by the Women in Medicine Legacy Foundation. And today is April the 11th. We're speaking at about 1:30 in the afternoon, Dr. Pinn's time, where she is in Washington, D.C. So I just want to say a few words to introduce Dr. Pinn and to indicate some of the accomplishments that have made her the subject of this oral history. So let me start by saying Dr. Vivian Pinn was the winner of the Women in Medicine Legacy Foundation Almadea Morani Award in 2020. And she will be joining a collection of oral histories of the Almadea Morani Award winners. She received her medical degree from the University of Virginia. That was in 1970. She was the only woman and the only minority.
That was 67.
67, okay. And the only minority in her class. And she from there developed a career in pathology, moving to Tufts University, where she also took on responsibility as the Associate Dean of Student Affairs. She advanced to professor and chair of pathology at Howard University College of Medicine in Washington. And then from there made a very lasting impact on the health of women and minorities and on the professional careers of women and minorities as the inaugural director of the NIH Office of Research on Women's Health, a position she held from 1991 until her retirement in 2011. And as she's been telling me in our preliminary conversations, her retirement has not been quiet. It has been full of accolades and commitments and engagements across many arenas from many directions. And it's all of that sort of rich history that I hope to explore with her over the next several interviews that we're going to conduct together. She's a recipient of dozens of awards and accolades. And I am really honored to be able to spend this time with her and delve into her history and contributions to the lives and careers, her own and those of many others in medicine. So thank you, Dr. Pinn. It's a great gift for you to spend time talking about yourself, something you've told me you're not always the most comfortable doing.
Thank you. I really am not comfortable talking about myself unless I'm pulling some example to make a point, I guess. So this is going to be interesting. I'll do the best I can. And thank you for the comments you just made.
Well, thank you. All right. Well, I think the easiest place for us to begin is to just begin at the beginning. And if you could tell me a little bit about where and when you were born and some of the things that shaped your early experiences as a child, I am so keen to hear a little bit more.
Well, it's interesting. I was born in Halifax County, Virginia. Both of my parents were school teachers. Interesting when I look back that of my four grandparents, three were college educated, which meant they finished. I know my grandfather finished Hampton in 1901, and I assume since he met my grandmother there that she was there about the same time. And my mother's mother had finished what was then St. Paul's College, a small HBCU in Virginia, which unfortunately no longer exists because of financial reasons. But I think education was important to my family, even though there were no advanced degrees. My mother eventually got a master's, but no one who was a physician in my family. But obviously education was important to them. When I think back, because both of my parents taught and they were not able to teach in the same school system, my father moved back to Lynchburg and Lynchburg, Virginia, which is where I really went to school and grew up, while my mother was still teaching in Halifax. So they sort of had a commuter marriage for a number of years until she could get a job.
How far apart are those cities?
Yes. And so I spent a lot of time with my grandparents, both my grandparents in Halifax County, which looking back, there was no electricity, no running water. I can still remember the well and the dipper and the barrel and And yes, the outhouse, but I didn't, we enjoyed being there. And in fact, in the summer, all my cousins would come down and join me there. And then I spent time in Lynchburg with my grandparents who, you know, so that they really took care of me as my parents taught. And so my grandparents had a great influence on me. I like to say that perhaps I'm told, at least I'm not sure I completely remember, but I'm told that at the age of four, I announced I wanted to be a pediatrician. And so, and my grandmother taught me how to spell it off of one of those beak. Young people may not remember this, but those of my generation will remember that in the 40s and 50s, banks and funeral homes would send out these large numbered calendars, page by page for the month. And I could still remember the red and white calendar on the wall. And my grandmother used that to teach me, I'm told, how to spell pediatrician, and that's what I thought I would be. And why? Well, my grandparents on my father's side in Lynchburg, where I spent a lot of time, my grandfather had cancer, had colorectal cancer, and was in a lot of pain. And my father would give him the shots for his painkillers when the doctor wasn't there. And I was the first grandchild. So yes, I was a little spoiled by my grandparents on both sides as the first grandchild. Mm-hmm. And which transferring now, I'm sort of the matriarch of both sides of my family, because I'm the oldest living relative on both sides of my family, my mother and father's side. But
you never lose that status, do you, all through life?
It comes with responsibility.
Yes, it does.
And actually, I guess the good thing about this is getting things recorded, because I'm being asked about things about family history. And I don't know what I knew so well once I never wrote down and don't always know. But
right.
But anyway, that's sort of a blessing and not a blessing to be the oldest. But I try to be there for all the members of my family when I can. But my grandfather told my father, because I would be there with him, why not let me do it? So my father taught me how to give the injections to my grandfather. Oh, and wow. At the same time, my grandmother had diabetes and was on insulin. And my father would give her her insulin shots. His sisters and brothers, no one else wanted to deal with needles. They didn't like needles. And so I was taught to do that. And so it was either my father or me that gave the needles. And not that I enjoyed giving needles, but I found being around my grandfather and watching my grandmother eat candy when she had diabetes that not that I enjoyed the sickness, but I enjoyed being able to do things to make them feel better. Mm-hmm. And that was the age of general practitioners who would come to your home making house calls.
Okay.
And during that time, the doctor would come, and when he would see my grandfather and see my grandmother, and then when he'd leave, everybody seemed to be happy, to be good. And it just impressed on me that the doctor's visit made everybody feel so much better. And I liked that there was a position that could really the family felt so much better after the doctor had been there and whatever he did to ease the pain or reassure them. And so I think that was the major influence for me I didn't know any women doctors. And actually later on, I think there were one or two women doctors in Lynchburg. There weren't many women that I didn't know very well, but there weren't many women in medicine anyway. And mm-hmm. certainly Black women in medicine was rare, mm-hmm. but I give credit to my family, because even though there were no physicians in our family, my father nor my mother ever said that as a little Black girl in, you know, segregated South, that I wouldn't be able to be a doctor. They just would say, if you want to be a doctor, you've got to study and you've got to work for it. And they never, never made me think that there was anything that would stop me, which is, I think, what got me through many of the challenges later on, because they were so supportive. And, you know, I met young women even years later whose families told them, women aren't doctors, or you should get married, or you should be something else. And to think that I was really fortunate to have parents and grandparents who supported yes. me and who never thought it was strange that I wanted to be a doctor. If you want to be a doctor, you know, you have to work for it. And my mother told me, you know, I couldn't use nail polish. I don't think I used colored nail polish till I was in my 20s, because she'd say, You know, if you're taking care of people who are sick, you've got to have clean nails. And if you have nail polish on, they won't be able to see that you've got clean nails. So there were all these little things, that little memories I have of my family, but it was all directed as a positive support for my idea of becoming a physician. So I think that's how I shaped my early memories and early interest in becoming a physician. And of course, you know the story of my mother. We can talk about that now or later, but that really sealed my idea to become a physician.
Yeah, maybe let me just linger over what you just told me, because I often find that people are creatures of their times. And so your grandparents, you know, early 20th century, your parents in the mid-century didn't hold those kinds of notions of women's roles, women's place, traditions, marriage, children, etc. How were they able to not be people of their time in a way, to be exceptional? Because I think you're right that there would be many women of your age, even of my age, that were given different messages subtly, if not overtly.
You know, I don't know. But I do know the fact that education was important, and that the fact that my grandmother, my mother's mother, my grandmother went to St. Paul's College. And I found out that actually her sisters also went. And in my mother's family, the girls all went to college, while the except for the youngest brother, the others, her many brothers, she was from a family of nine. The brothers all went in the military to send money home to help support their sisters in college. So sort of the reverse of what most people think, but that concept, my grandmother went to college and her sisters, and in my mother's family, her brothers all went into the military, and then they supported my mother and her sisters in college. Her youngest brother, by that time, all the sisters were college educated. So her youngest brother actually did get a college degree, but it was sort of like supporting the women in the family to get the education, sort of a reverse of what you think of what most people were doing. And in my father's family, my grandfather was very brilliant and finished college at a time when not many people. It's interesting. There's a story about my grandfather that's sort of a legend, in that he was actually a Cherokee Indian and was with his family, and he decided he wanted to get an education and not be, because at that time people would refer to Indians as being dumb, and so he wanted to not be one of those dumb Indians they were referring to. And he hopped a freight train, literally, you hear stories, but he packed his trunk, I don't think he really had a trunk, whatever he had, and hopped a train and went to Hampton Institute. And at that time, Hampton had a special government program to educate Indians. And he was educated in that program. And I actually have a photo of my grandfather in the class at Hampton Institute with the group that he was with, that must have been from about 1900, 1901. So he had this idea. But when he finished college, there were not many opportunities for Blacks at that time to use their college degrees. So, so my grandmother, my mother's side taught school. My grandmother, who was college educated on my father's side, she had nine children too, so she took care of the children. But my grandfather ended up starting a business, and he did very well with his business, a trucking business, and was very good at that. And most of the sons, except my father, who was a teacher, worked in that family business. But
I see.
I would talk to him, and he participated in plays, and you know, I have a few of his books I kept just because I knew they were his. But he had the idea for education too. And so all of his daughters went to college and were college educated. Most of them went on to get master's degree. Again, most of the brothers went in the military. And that was during the time when there were drafts in place. So all of my father's brothers went in the military, except my father, who was teaching and somehow was exempt because he was teaching health education or something like that.
Okay.
So we sort of look on that story of my grandfather hopping a freight train. But I know he was there. I've got a picture of him in that class. So whether he hopped a freight train or not, that's what happened. So again,
so it's almost like your older generations all went against stereotypes themselves, not gender stereotypes, per se, but many stereotypes.
Yes.
They know that those are there to be overturned.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm very fortunate in that, I think. You know, my families weren't well-to-do, as I said. You know, my grandmother and my mother grew up on the farm where I spent a lot of time with well water, and, you know, we joke about bathing in the tin tub on the back porch. And among my cousins, we have a family Zoom now, and it's interesting because everybody looks back on that. It was sort of like going to camp when they came down.
Right.
And we have fond memories of that and that wonderful well water, which you wouldn't dare drink now. But it didn't seem repressive to us. It was just, that was it. And then I go to Lynchburg where they had telephones and electricity and nice houses. And, you know, I sort of balanced between the two. But I think in all of that, perhaps because I was the oldest grandchild on both sides, I was really nourished by both families. And while they did maybe spoil me a little bit, my parents, both from big families, raised me as though I was not the only child. And so, you know, I was not going to have that only child syndrome of being spoiled. And so I always had the responsibility. My mother said she had the responsibility as the oldest in her family of taking care of all the sisters and brothers. I didn't have sisters and brothers, but I was responsible for taking care of cousins or anybody else. And that
even
probably
your grandparents and their needles. Yeah.
That's right. I think that probably also contributed to my feeling of wanting to take care of people because it was expected of me.
Right. Right. Yeah, I can see that. Those positive messages you described from coming from your family, what was it like in school for you? Were those duplicated as a young girl or not? And the other thing I was going to ask you, Vivian, is, you know, I'm Canadian. I immigrated to Texas about 10 years ago. And I realized as I was reading your histories and some of your accomplishments, I've never spoken to anyone who grew up in a segregated part of the U.S. I've seen it in movies. I've read it in books, but I've never, that seems strange, doesn't it? But as a Canadian, that's not my circle. So I felt like if you could describe to me a bit what it was like to be in a segregated city.
My city was segregated. Everything was segregated. I was one of those that rode on the back of the bus. You know, you could get on the bus, pay your fare in the front, but you went to the back of the bus. Our schools were segregated. I laugh and say maybe I don't have much bladder function now, because if I went downtown and we walked everywhere, I can't believe I walked the distances I walked. But as as a teenager or something, you go downtown to Main Street, typical small town. And if you wanted to eat, I can remember there was, I don't know if it was a Kresge's or Woolworth, and they had the best looking hot dogs, but we couldn't eat them there. You could go to the end of the counter and order one and they'd give you one, but you had to take it out. You couldn't eat there. And if you wanted to go to the bathroom, there were very few bathrooms on Main Street that were labeled colored. Most of them were just white bathrooms. And so if I wanted to go to the bathroom and needed, got that urge, and there was not a bus there, I had to walk all the way up Main Street, all the way up 12th Street, and all the way home to go to the bathroom, because I didn't want to use the one or two, and there weren't that many, but one or two not well kept up colored bathrooms. So I say maybe that ruined my bladder control later on, but as a joke, but it really, that really did happen.
Yeah.
Being in a segregated school, we didn't have, the teachers were, the good thing was the teachers were nurturing. And for me, with so many aunts and my father in the school system, everybody knew me and everybody knew my family. So if I took one step out of line, my father would know before the school day was
before
over.
Before you got home. Yeah.
That's right. But, you know, but it was nurturing and we all knew each other. So integration of schools didn't happen until midway through my college career. So, so you're now talking to someone who lived through segregated schools, segregated cities. There, now it's so easy to go out to a restaurant, but think back when I was growing up, there were no restaurants there. You know, I think there was one in Atlanta called Pascal's. So if we were driving south, you try to make it from Virginia to Atlanta so you could go to Pascal's, which is one place where Blacks could stop. You didn't want to drive in the dark. You wanted to be in the bright lights because you were afraid of cops in the South. because of those that had disappeared or other things that happened to. And this was just sort of our way of life, you know, looking and realizing, you know, Ku Klux Klan is marching on the other side of town. And my uncle once said, I'd walk from my grandparents' home to my home. And I remember my uncle once saying, you know, you stay here now because the Klan is out in the streets. And, you know, I didn't get picked up by them. But that was the environment in which I grew up. Everything was segregated.
Yeah.
No place to go out to eat. You mean go out to eat? Going out to eat meant going to somebody else's home. In the movies, they gave us, there was one theater, which was the Black Theater. And I remember that because on Saturdays, all of us would go, Black kids, and my father would give me a quarter and take me there, 9 cents for admission, 10 cents for popcorn, 5 cents for a drink from the machine, and a penny left over for either Tootsie Rolls or mint candy. But we'd all be there. And eventually, the big theaters downtown decided they'd let us in, but we had to go in a side door, go up the steps on the outside, and they reserved half a balcony for us. So that was it. But you couldn't go in the main way. I can still remember we had to go in the side door, up steps, and then we were limited to half of the balcony was partitioned off. So, I mean, anything you ask about, I can tell you it was segregated.
Healthcare was also segregated.
What?
Healthcare? How did that look and how did that go forward?
Well, remember that. Well, at that time, yes, we had. I think there were maybe 4 or 5 Black general practitioners in town. My pediatrician was white because there were no Black pediatricians. Mm. And thinking back, I don't know how that worked, but I did have a white pediatrician. But the thing was, and that you could go to other doctors, specialists, if you had to be referred to them. But that was during the time when the AMA was still forbidding Blacks to join the AMA.
Right.
So the Black doctors in my hometown and through most of the South and even in the North did not have hospital privileges, because in order to have hospital privileges, you had to belong to the AMA. And the AMA was denying membership to Black physicians. So that meant that if I went in the hospital, which I did, or if my mother went in the hospital, the Black doctors could refer them to the hospital, but they could only visit them as friends. They couldn't take care of them as patients. So you had to have a white doctor to see you. So I grew up during that time when Black doctors were not allowed hospital privileges because of the AMA. I think, you know, maybe it's been maybe 15, 20 years now. The AMA, well, obviously the AMA has become integrated over recent years, and I guess about 15 or 20 years ago, issued a public apology for what they did. But that doesn't change what we lived through and what physicians went through, because they really had no access to hospitals and other privileges that they might have had because they couldn't join the AMA. And that is why the National Medical Association was founded.
Yes.
I think if anybody looks at my history or knows me, they know how involved I've been in the National Medical Association. That was organized so that Black physicians would have an organization, could hold scientific meetings, get to know each other as an alternative to the AMA. And the NMA really helped fight to get that, to be able to have privileges in hospitals and restore the rights, and eventually to get AMA to admit to either admit Black physicians or hospitals to accept Black physicians on their staff. Not many know that, but that's the case. So I've been a member of the NMA now since about 1970, and I have served as the second woman president of the NMA.
Yes.
And I'm now chair of the past president's council.
Oh, are you? That
I'm
I didn't
chair
know.
Of the past president's council of the NMA. Sometimes I think I'm sort of the grandmother of NMA because I've been a member so long, but I adore that organization, but it has great benefits. I belong to the AMA now also, as well as, but there were times when I couldn't join the AMA. And I remember when I eventually did join about 30 years ago, I did join because I had to work with them as president of NMA. But
right.
Up until that time, I had not joined because I remembered when we could not join.
Yes. Yeah, that was something I think when you describe that kind of living to me as a child. Did it impress upon you? You know, I can think many things, being afraid. I can think about being resentful. I can think about being rebellious. I can think about being determined. But I'm curious, what do you feel?
I don't remember being scared. I think my father was known for being outspoken in his temper and not a bad temper, but speaking up and not taking nonsense. And my mother was very sweet and shy. I think shy and just lovely, graceful person. My father was the one that was outspoken. And I say sometimes I'm like my mother, but other times I'm like my father in being outspoken. And I can remember when some things happened and my father thought it wasn't right. He thought nothing about saying, no, that's not right, and protecting those that he knew from police intervention, or especially around the schools and things. Mm-hmm. But I don't remember being scared, except I remember the talk about the Ku Klux Klan, but I don't even really remember being scared of that, because we didn't have any lynchings or anything where we were, but I just knew to keep my place. Mm-hmm. I can remember maybe one time I was scared when my cousins would come down from the north, and they were in integrated cities. They were in New York and Indianapolis and in Boston, and they were not living in segregated. And so they'd come and they would, I'm going to sit in the front of the bus. And I'm like, no, you please go back. You know, I'm going to sit in the front of the bus. And I'm thinking, this was before, long before Rosa Parks.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, I don't know what will happen if you take that seat. And I wasn't brave enough to be like Rosa Parks and to sit there. But I can remember that was when I was a little frightened, because I didn't know what would happen if they actually took a seat in the front.
Right.
But other than that, I think you sort of knew what you were dealing with. I had been to other cities where there was integration. I think what we got most upset about were some of the state things that helped support schools for segregationists once integration began, and they did not want their kids to go to integrated schools. And so the state helped pay for tuition for private schools. And interesting along that line, because at that time, which is interesting since I eventually went to UVA for medical school, during my time growing up, none of the HBCUs, the historically Black colleges and universities in Virginia, offered graduate degrees. They were colleges, not universities.
Right.
And so for those who wanted to get an advanced degree, like a master's, the state, rather than opening up, you know, the universities in Virginia where you could get a graduate degree, rather than opening those up to integrate them, they instead would pay for tuition if you went out of state. So my mother and my aunts, they all went to NYU or Columbia to get masters, and their friends and other teachers. And I can remember in the summertime walking a campus with my mother, and I'd see everybody I knew, the older teachers from home, because they were all up there getting their masters, because Virginia would pay for them, but not in Virginia. They weren't allowed in the school. So a lot of things people don't realize, but that's how it was. And I guess we lived with it best we could. We didn't like it, but mm-hmm. we did small things, but we weren't the militant ones out, unfortunately, I guess. Militant ones out holding sit-ins, et cetera, but mm-hmm. we knew our place, but we didn't really like our place. Mm-hmm. But we made our place comfortable for us.
Okay.
And admired. And some of those who were in the civil rights movement, I knew or I met later and got to know, and my heart was with them. And I supported what they did, but my city itself wasn't as involved as some of the other southern cities. Okay. So I can't say I did much more than that.
Mm-hmm. Sort of activist in a different way, which is accomplishing all that you could accomplish.
And I think my life has been one of sort of quiet activism. I speak out often when others don't speak out, but I also get a lot done behind the scenes, so to speak. So I say that's my militant activist side. That I speak out when I must, but sometimes I find I can get more things done being that activist behind the scenes, and I've done that a lot.
Mm-hmm. I love that phrase, a quiet activist. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. Thank you for painting the picture for me that is hard to hear, but informative at the same time for someone who, yeah, those personal stories are not something I've heard because they aren't part of my background.
Yeah. But probably it's fortunate that you didn't experience it or you know, that segregation didn't exist where you were. For us, it was, I just think of those that lost their lives battling to overcome segregation and the fear, especially when you went into Alabama, Mississippi, the fear about being able to drive there, drive through. And it wasn't just my family, it was something in general. I knew personally a professional athlete who was from Louisiana and he had a nice car. And he told me driving home to Louisiana, he would only drive to Alabama and Mississippi in the daylight to get to Louisiana, because with a nice car, he always had that fear that he would be pulled over. Why is this Black man driving this nice car? And would never do it at night. So we all kind of worked with the system to protect ourselves. But I had nothing but admiration for Martin Luther King and for those others who were involved. And there's still a few of them who are alive now. But what really is most distressing to me is that all of these things we fought for in different ways in the 40s and 50s are coming back in today's political environment. And it just, my friends, my family, my colleagues, not just Blacks, but in general, all are having the same reaction I am. We are going back where there's voter suppression and ways to, well, I won't talk about the incident that just happened, but where we're being put out of state legislations for almost nothing. And that's a current event of today. It's just so distressing to us because we thought we had fought all these battles and gotten through them. And now they're rising again. And how and why? I know I have voted. As soon as I turned 18, I started to vote. And I have never missed an opportunity to vote. And I get, maybe because of my background and what I went through and what I saw others go through, I get so angry and lose total respect for those folks who say they don't need to vote because their vote won't count. Have they forgotten the people who lost their lives, or people like me that had to walk from downtown home to go to the bathroom because I wasn't allowed in, or had to climb the steps to get in the theater, or saw relatives who couldn't vote because they'd be turned away, and then to the arrogance of those today who feel they don't have to vote. And we've seen over and over, small number of votes can make a difference. Anyway, that you can see my passion about this.
Yeah.
So my guess, I can say that the effects of growing up in segregation really kind of molded me into being more the quiet activist, sometimes the outspoken activist, but feeling very passionate about civil rights.
And in medicine too, I would assume. I've seen.
Yes, obviously, because working with the NMA over the years And of course, NMA really, I mean, we have purely scientific sessions, but we also focus on health disparities, look at when physicians are mistreated. And we see that even today where their license is being yanked or they're being put in jail with charges we just don't understand. They can come to our organization. Students who have difficulty, medical students, because still sometimes those incidents happen that really are not the students' fault, and they can find in our organization that support. And it's, you know, I love it because many of my students from the early years, from the 70s and 80s, have come and joined the NMA, and I get to see them. And it's also striking to me that now many of my students from the 70s are retired. And so they're retiring, and I'm like, why am I still out here working, doing things? But it's a nice for socialization too, but that's not our main focus. But you're right, activists, especially in medicine, and I think I have been outspoken in many ways related to that.
Yeah, I know we're going to come to that as we go further down the road in the story of your life. I thought I would just ask you one more question about those early years, and that is something I read in some of the material that I've been perusing. And the role of the church in your life, in your early life and moving forward, I gather it was an important institution for you.
Actually, it was. My father's family was Baptist. My mother's family was Methodist. And so when they got married, they joined the Episcopal Church.
Yes, yes.
And so our Episcopal Church was small. So there were many Sundays I would go to Baptist Sunday school, mm-hmm. and then come back to go to church at my church for church services. It was so small that, you know, we had a dedicated congregation, but there were not many of us. And in the summertime, often when the few boys in the church grew up, it was not unusual for me to be the altar boy because we had no boy there. And in the summer, when I saw a lot of kids in my hometown went up to Connecticut, there were faculty or people would take groups of high schoolers to Connecticut, mm-hmm. to work in the tobacco fields to make money during the summer. And our church organist and her husband were one of the couples who did that. So I was the summer organist for our church. So it wasn't unusual to be the altar boy, be playing the organ at our church. My father was the deacon, and we were there all the time. So yes, when I got to college, I took a lot. Wellesley requires you to Wellesley's where I went to college, and I don't know if it's still there, but when I was there, you were required to take a year of Bible history. And I actually took some advanced courses because I was really invested in really, really interested in some of the biblical history. And I remember calling my family, and calls were rare then because you had to pay for them after 11 o'clock. It was cheaper and all, but I don't know why, but I mentioned some of the things that had come up in my Bible class. And my parents, I found out later, were horrified. They thought I was going against the Bible, but I was trying to explain some of the current theories about some of the biblical teachings we learned. So I learned it's better not to discuss with them these other theories that I'm getting, but I did a lot with that. And I actually was very active in the church, but I maybe because I grew up in a small church where I was maybe overly involved. Once I got to college and lived in Boston, I sought out the Trinity Church in Copley Square, which is a large church, a large Episcopal church. But I loved being in a crowd where no one knew me as such, where I could just enjoy my religion. And I loved the environment and the messages from the ministers there. And actually, my college roommate got married in that church, so that's how I found out about it. So I loved not being the activist in church, but I wanted to just be enveloped.
People who put on the worship have a different experience of worship, don't they?
That's right, yes. Yeah. I think I had my fill of small churches, but, you know, and for a while, actually, it didn't drive me away from religion, but it really affected me when my mother died. And our small church, they were just, because churches were segregated too, obviously.
Right.
And they were just starting to integrate the churches. So our
around
church,
what time was that, Vivian?
My mother died in February 61. So this is 60, 61. So our church was still there, but minister was getting ready to leave, and they were expecting our church members to become involved in another in what was then the quote unquote white Episcopal church. Mm-hmm. So when my mother died, they thought that probably our church was too small for those to be attending because big families and all of her former students. So they decided that I don't know how it was decided, but anyway, that church, we would hold the funeral at the quote unquote white church.
Oh.
And I was asking for, in planning the funeral, I wanted them to play the Lord's Prayer because while my mother was ill and she knew she was dying, we would play. There was music she liked, Ave Maria and the Lord's Prayer. And we would play those on our record player, and it brought comfort to her. And I wanted to have the Lord's Prayer as one of the musical selections. And the minister there said, no, you can't have it. And I said, why not? He said, the organist refuses to play it because he doesn't think it's really a religious song.
Oh.
And I mean, what do you mean? This organist is determined. And I went back crazy. You know, I've got 2 years of studying a biblical history at Wellesley. I'm not some dumbass, and you're not going to let me because the organist is going to refuse. They did not play that at my mother's funeral.
Oh.
And I think that was one way of reacting to a Black funeral coming to the church. But
yes.
He said it was the organist. I don't know, but I you know, that just did something to me, and that's the Southern Church. I'll probably never get over that, because that meant something to her and to my father and to me. And it is a religious song. And every time I go to a funeral now and the Lord's Prayer is sung, I think back to that organist in that church. Anyway, yeah. That's another fan. What does that have to do with my career? I don't know, but it's something that's in my mind.
But it sets the stage for the woman who had the career. So I thank you for that. Yeah. Helps us to know her a little bit. So, yeah. And I know those times of raw grief, I feel as though I would like to maybe move to the story of your college years and your mother's death, but I know it's 1 o'clock. And I know that's a complicated and difficult story to tell. And I know you have obligations this afternoon.
Yeah.
So do you want to pause at this point?
Yes, why don't we? We'll start back tomorrow. You get me talking and all these old memories. I hope I'm not too far off track, but these old memories come back to me as we talk.
Then you know what? That tells me that this is a rich oral history, because it is those stories and those memories that oral history is meant to capture. So I can't thank you enough. And they bring me into your world and your life in a way that the details of your CV could never do.
Yeah.
I appreciate it.
Nobody would guess that I grew up, spent a lot of time on a farm drinking water out of the well and getting eggs from the hen house, and they'd probably never think about my having those experiences. So
no, absolutely not.
But and that's why when people planning they want to go camping, I said I'd camped enough when I was a child. Give me a luxury hotel. I've done that camping bit. Give me a luxury hotel. So
and yet it's a fond memory for you and your cousins.
Yeah, we just enjoyed it. We talk about, it's funny, it comes up almost, you remember bathing in that basin on the back porch, and it's true, because you had to heat some water and then pour it into this big tin basin. And usually it was on the back porch, and then that's where you bathed, and then going out to the field to pick the corn or get the potatoes to come in to cook on that wood stove that was in the kitchen, and in the winter not burning your behind when you're backing up to the wood burning stove trying to keep warm or get warm. But we look back, I mean, we didn't think anything about it then, and it's funny, we all look back with just fond memories of those times then. So
not hardship, but fondness.
No, yeah, we look back that, you know, you remember this, you remember that, remember being bathed, remember going, do you remember there was a black walnut tree right outside the, no, I don't remember that, was it still there?
You're right.
You know, so it's those memories come back, and I think it's interesting, those that spent a lot of time there, and those who only came a few times, we all still have those memories and enjoy talking about them, so.
Yeah.